Namaste. Namaste everyone. Welcome to second PUC physics class. Today we will discuss about a new chapter, that is electromagnetic waves. Namaste. Welcome to the class. Hope you are doing well. So we have to start from Ampere's circular law, because lots of work were going on about electric field and magnetic fields. But some scientists started thinking about what is the source of this electric and magnetic field. And some have gone beyond and thought that there should be a common source which can produce both electric and magnetic fields. Because some experiments say, like for example, Oersted's discovery says that whenever there is a current flowing through a conductor, there is a magnetic field around it. And that magnetic field is because of the current flowing through the conductor. And electromagnetic induction by Faraday said that whenever there is, it showed that whenever there is a change in the magnetic flux linked with a coil, that induces a current in the coil. So one is brought from another. So one can be produced from another. So there should be some linking factor or a common factor for both. So lots of thinking and lots of experiment were going on in the earlier days. And when it comes to the question of unification of electric and magnetic fields, you get so many names like Faraday's experiments, and Hertz experiment, and Oersted's discovery, and so many things. And a new name is James Clerk Maxwell. Maxwell found out some inconsistency in the formula of Ampere. Ampere's circuital law. We will have a quick review of Ampere's circuital law. It is used to find out the magnetic field at a point due to a current carrying conductor, right? If you have an infinitely long straight wire, if you want to find out what is the magnetic field at any point due to this infinitely long straight wire, then you can apply Ampere's circuital law. Ampere's circuital law says that closed integral of B dot dl is equal to mu naught times the current through the area bounded by the loop. So closed integral of B dot dl is equal to mu naught times the current enclosed by the area bounded by a loop. So if you want to apply Ampere's circular law in order to find out the magnetic field due to any current carrying wire, you have to select the point first. So this is the conductor and it is infinitely long, imagine. And you want to find out the magnetic field here. Ampere says if you want to find out the magnetic field at any point, you imagine a loop of any shape, closed loop, such that that loop contains that point itself. So now better choice here is, we are finding the magnetic field at a distance r. So better choice here is to consider a circular loop, right? It is the best choice because it is symmetrical. And you consider a circular loop like this, so that this conductor passes through the center of the loop and this distance is r. It is the radius of the loop, right? So Ampere says you just traverse through the loop, or you just go on traveling on the loop. As you travel through the loop, whatever the magnetic field you get, the magnitude of magnetic field, dot dl, of course, whatever the magnetic field you get, and its dot product with the element that you take from the that loop, keep on doing it for the closed loop completely, then that must be equal to mu naught times the I. I is the current through the area bounded by that loop. Okay, now if you go on doing like this, I have selected a circular loop. That helps you a lot. Why? Because magnetic field surrounding a conductor is very similar to circular loops. So if you take a conductor carrying current like this, I had a pen and yeah, it is here. So if you have a conductor carrying current like this, clasp it with the right hand, such that the thumb shows the direction of current. Then the remaining fingers will show the direction of magnetic field like this. So it is also circular around the current carrying conductor. If the magnetic field is also in the form of circular loops, then as you traverse through this Amperean loop like this, little by little, you divide this into a number of elements, dl, 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 number of elements, travel through dl, the magnetic field will be in the same direction as you travel through this small part of the element. So if you take one part here of length dl, as you traverse across this, magnetic field and dl will be in the same directions. So if you expand this, then closed integral of b dl cos theta, cos theta, cos theta is cos 0, it becomes 1, and is equal to mu naught times I. But as you traverse through the closed loop, Amperean loop, whatever you call. So this is the idea that Ampere have given. In order to find out the magnetic field, you imagine a loop so that that current carrying wire or anything passes through that loop, then traverse through the loop into dividing it into a number of elements. And when you traverse, what is the direction of the magnetic field and what is the direction of that element, and find out the cos theta. Here cos zero is 1. What about B? B is same everywhere, because if you consider the distance from the wire to the circumference of the loop, that distance is same everywhere. So magnetic field magnitude must be same everywhere. Only the thing remaining here is dl. So you can, this is 1, this is B. So B into closed integral of dl, and that is equal to mu naught times the current enclosed in the area bounded by the loop. Now what is dl, dl, dl over the full circular ampere and loop? Then that is nothing but 2 pi r, because this is 2 pi r, the closed integral of dl elements, then it is equal to mu naught times I. That is how we write the magnetic field due to a magnetic field due to a straight infinitely long wire carrying current I is given by mu naught by 2 pi I by r. And here the current through the area bounded by the loop itself is I, because that loop, ampere and loop which we have drawn, contains or includes only one wire, that infinitely long wire itself. So there is no other wire, so current through that wire itself is I. Suppose we had one more wire, you should have written 2 I. So because this statement is like this, it is mu naught times the net current enclosed in the area bounded by the loop. Whatever the ampere and loop you have considered, you may be it is circular or rectangular. In the case of solenoid, you have taken rectangular. Just go back to that magnetism chapter and you can recall all the applications of Ampere's circuital law. So the net current in the area bounded by the loop, because that is I only. So this is B. Now, Maxwell tried and he tried to apply this to find out the magnetic field between the plates of a capacitor. So he took a capacitor, and you know what is a capacitor? It is a device used to store charges or energy, and it consists of two metal plates separated by a small dielectric medium, right? Separated by a small gap, and that gap is always filled with a dielectric medium. Here you have a dielectric medium. And suppose this capacitor is connected to a battery and switched on. You know that the charging process, electrons will be taken from, say this is the positive and this is negative, if it is so like this, then electrons will be removed from this plate, and those electrons will be taken away and will be put to the other plate. When the electrons are removed from here, this gets positively charged, because one which loses electrons gets positively charged, so more and more positively charged, and this, as this receives electron, it gets negatively charged. But how does the charging process continue? Initially, the electrons will be flowing more and more in bulk, because the flow will be easier. But as the electrons get accumulated here, they will repel the arrival of the next electron. So the flow of electrons becomes lesser and lesser. That means current flowing through the circuit when the capacitor is charging is not uniform current. It is a varying current. So initially, in the first few hours of our first few seconds of time, the charging process will be faster, and later the current becomes slower and slower. At one fine moment, the electrons cannot flow from one plate to the another, because all the electrons arrived here will successively oppose the arrival of the next electrons, and so the flow charging process stops. That means current becomes zero. So in the beginning current will be maximum, and later the current will be lesser and lesser. So what type of electric field will be developed between the plates here in the insulator? Electric field initial will be weaker, and charges will be accumulated lesser and lesser in the beginning, and as the electrons are flowing more and one by one, the amount of charge here goes on increasing, and the electric field is growing. So current in the circuit is a variable one, and electric field between the plates is also a variable one. Now, Maxwell tried to find out the magnetic field due to this straight wire carrying current here. Because there is a current here, say I will show it in this direction, I, right? And that I is a variable I, it is not a uniform I, okay? So if the electrons flow like this from this plate to this plate, current will be in the opposite direction. So if you want to use Ampere's circuital law and want to find out what is the magnetic field here, you have to imagine an ampere loop Of course, again, circle is the best choice at a distance r. Of course, same procedure goes. And B dot closed integral of dot product of magnetic field and the element dl. If you divide it into number of pieces, closed integral of B dot dl is equal to mu naught times the net current in the area and bounded by the loop. The area bounded by the loop is here, and only this wire is carrying current, so only I. Now, Maxwell tried to expand it. He was not satisfied with finding the magnetic field due to that wire itself, wire only. And he found that there is a magnetic field inside the capacitor also, between the plates. Now, how to find it out? What is the strength of the magnetic field at the same type of point here inside the capacitor? How to find out the strength of the magnetic field here? And if you imagine that this like a tiffin box like this, and if you complete this, and if you imagine a loop like this here, in order to find out the magnetic field inside the between the plates of the capacitor, in a similar point, what we have done here also, if you want to find out the magnetic field, extend this circle to the right side. You will get a cylindrical arrangement. Let it be like a tiffin box. And now the circular loop that we are considering here, it will be here, and that contains the point P also. Now, what is the magnetic field here? If you want to apply this, closed integral of B dot dl must be equal to mu naught times, we get zero. Why? Why this is zero here? Simple reason. That Ampere loop does not enclose any current. That Ampere loop was enclosing a current passing through this conductor here, but no current is enclosed by the Ampere loop between the plates of the capacitor. So this should be zero then, because dl cannot be zero. Because we have considered an Ampere loop, so there is a dl, but this implies that there is B is equal to zero. But actually there is magnetic field inside the capacitor plates, or between the capacitor plates. Then why can't Ampere's circuital law find out the magnetic field between the plates, or identify some magnetic field between the plates of the capacitor, charging capacitor? Maxwell came to a conclusion that something is missing in the Ampere's circuital law, and because of some missing current, it gave magnetic field B is equal to zero. What is that missing current? That should be one more current, because the magnetic field between the plates of the capacitor existing is 100% sure. But Ampere's circuital law doesn't help us to find out that magnetic field. So that inconsistency, that means according to Maxwell, Ampere's circuital law, that formula is inconsistent. Inconsistency in the sense, it cannot be applied everywhere. And you have to make it complete now, so that it can be applied everywhere. How to make it complete? So he just thought of to find out a current here. That should be current between the plates of the capacitor. How? That current may be produced because of timely varying electric field. That's how he thought of. So magnetic field can be produced not only by timely varying magnetic field can be produced by by passing current through a conductor. Magnetic field can also be produced by a timely varying electric field. So he proved it. Now, what is the flux through any area here? Or what is the electric flux between the plates of the capacitor? You know that the actual capacitor plates will be like this. They will be like this. Say they are rectangular metal plates, and the magnetic field lines will be normal to the surface of these metal plates. And say the A is the area of the plates, and if the electric field lines are directed like this, then flux is equal to the formula, electric flux through any surface is E delta S cos theta. Actually, it is the dot product of electric field and the surface area, normal to the surface area. Dot product of electric field and normal to the surface area, delta S, gives the flux, or area, of course. It becomes a vector because of its normal to the surface, that direction. Okay, E dot delta S. We have studied this formula. And if you apply this here, what is the flux through this plates or the surface area? Flux between the plates of the capacitor is equal to E. Delta S is A, area of the plates, because we will find out the flux through the full area. Then what is the angle between the normal? Of course, this is E delta S cos theta. Okay, I will expand it. E delta is cos theta, where theta is angle between the normal to the surface and electric field lines. That is 0, cos 0, 1. So EA cos 0. Delta S is A, E is electric field, EA cos 0. So what is flux? EA. But what is E? Recall the formulas. Electric field is can be expressed in terms of surface density. What is surface density? Surface density is the charge per unit area, right? Charge distributed uniformly over an unit area of surface. Then E is equal to sigma by epsilon naught. Recall all these formulas. So I will replace E as sigma by epsilon naught into A. Sigma is surface density of charge. That is also equal to, what is sigma? Sigma is charge by area into 1 by epsilon naught into A. Charge by area into 1 by epsilon naught into A. A gets cancelled. Phi is equal to Q by epsilon naught. Now, okay, let us find out the rate of change of flux, because you know that between the plates of the capacitor, as the capacitor charges, the electric field becomes stronger and stronger as it gets more and more charged. The amount of charge doesn't remain constant, it keeps on changing. Okay, so what is d phi by dt then? Rate of change of flux. Of course, this is electric flux, I have to mention this. The flux due to electric field, not magnetic field. The flux of electric field, d phi e by dt, is equal to d by dt of q by epsilon naught. Epsilon naught is a constant, but what is d phi e by dt? That is equal to rate of change of flux is equal to 1 by epsilon naught. What is dq by dt? It is I. Because dq by dt is equal to rate of flow of charges, it is called current I. So what is I? I is equal to epsilon naught d phi e by dt. So there is a current then. So what is that missing current that we have came across when we were applying the formula for finding the magnetic field, Ampere's formula for finding the magnetic field between the plates of capacitor? That missing current itself is this one. That is how Maxwell came to know, or he came to a conclusion that even the timely varying electric field can also produce a current. And that current is missing in Ampere's circular law. You have to include that current also. Then you will get the magnetic field between the plates of the capacitor. So while finding the magnetic field between the plates of the capacitor, you are missing one current. So that inconsistent formula of Ampere was completed, and it was made complete by Maxwell. So we call it as Ampere-Maxwell law. That is like this. Closed integral of B dot dl is equal to mu naught times two currents, not single current, mu naught times one is this conduction current, that is this one, ordinary current, the current produced by any flow of charges in a conductor, drift of electrons in a conductor, that is conduction current, plus he called this current as displacement current. Displacement current is because of the timely varying electric field. So IC plus ID. So this was missing. That's why he was not able to get magnetic field here by applying Ampere's circular law. So this is Ampere-Maxwell law. It is now consistent. You can apply it anywhere. So if you expand this, so if you are asked to write what is Ampere-Maxwell law, B dot dl is equal to mu naught times the conduction current plus mu naught times the displacement current. What is displacement current? Epsilon naught d phi by dt, where phi is electric field, electric flux. So this is the complete equation now. Now, between the plates of the capacitor, since electric field is changing, there is a displacement current. So what do you mean by displacement current? Current produced because of the timely varying electric field is called displacement current. What is the formula for displacement current? ID is equal to epsilon naught into d phi by dt, where phi is the electric flux. And what is conduction current? Current in a conductor because of the motion of electrons or drift of electrons is called conduction current. So at and where do you get conduction current and where do you get displacement current, sir? See, at some places magnetic field may be produced only because of displacement current. For example, if you have a pure conductor and a very good conductor, then the magnetic field at a point around the conductor is produced only because of the conduction current, because only we have an electric field. What happens to the equation here now? Why don't you have displacement current at all here? Why don't you have displacement current here? Why do you have only conduction current in a pure conductor? So when you pass current through a conductor, there is an electric field inside also. So an electric field is produced inside the conductor, but that electric field is uniform electric field in the sense it is not a timely varying electric field. I don't say it is uniform. It is not a timely varying electric field, it is a constant electric field. So when it is with respect to time, when it is a constant electric field, what happens to d phi by dt? It becomes zero, because flux doesn't change with time inside the current carrying conductor. So there is no displacement current. So magnetic field produced by a pure conductor carrying current, or magnetic field around a pure conductor carrying current, is only because of conduction current, because the electric field is fixed, it doesn't change with time, so there is no displacement current. Whereas the magnetic field produced between the plates of a capacitor, it is purely because of displacement current, because there is a timely varying electric field and that timely varying electric field produces current. So current and magnetic field, or magnetic field at a point, may be only because of conduction current, it may be only because of displacement current, and it may be because of both also at some places. How? Suppose you have a material, and usually we have all the materials which are not perfect conductors, which are not perfect insulators, isn't it? So all the materials are not perfect insulators and perfect conductors. So if you have a mixture of both, it's partly a conductor, partly an insulator, then and the magnetic field produced by such a material may be because of both timely varying electric field as well as the magnetic field. Timely varying electric field as well as due to the conduction current. So it may be because of displacement current, also because of conduction current. So at a point, magnetic field may be only because of displacement current, only because of conduction current, and only because of conduction current, a conductor carrying current, and only because of displacement current inside between the plates of a capacitor, you can have both magnetic field due to both also. So this is Ampere-Maxwell law, which is a combination. So very small thing, a very minute thing actually, but you have to go deep into the topic, and you must have a clear awareness of this Ampere's circuital law. Then only you will understand why it made Maxwell to think of the unification of electric and magnetic field. So this made Maxwell to think of the area where Huygens went wrong. Huygens said that light is a wave. He was the first person to say that light is a wave. But his theory was a very strong theory. Huygens wave theory was a very strong theory, and Huygens wave theory was able to explain interference, diffraction, reflection, refraction, and while coming to the point of polarization, you know that only the transverse waves can be polarized. But when it came to the question of light was undergoing polarization. That means it should be transverse. So Huygens corrected himself that light is a transverse wave, so it can be polarized. So everything was explained using Huygens except one thing. How does light travel in vacuum? Even if there is no medium, light can travel. If it is a wave, how could it travel in vacuum? That was the question posed to Huygens. Huygens said that there is an hypothetical medium called ether everywhere. Using ether medium, it travels. But it is not a satisfactory answer because it has no base. So that is the point where Huygens' theory had a very strong drawback. Maxwell thought that light may be a wave. It is a wave, but it's not an ordinary wave which uses the medium. It is a different wave, and he called it as electromagnetic wave. Light is an electromagnetic wave, and it is a combination of electric and magnetic fields. That is what the explanation given by Huygens. And this made him to think that light may be a combination of electric and magnetic fields. Because whenever there is a change in the magnetic field around a coil, it induces a current, right? Whenever there is a change in the electric field, it produces a current, and both can produce magnetic field, right? So electric field due to some changes can contribute to magnetic field, and magnetic field because of its own changes can contribute to electric field. So both are like very good friends. So wherever there is electric field, there should be a magnetic field at the same point. So they are complement, they are just supporting each other, so they should have the same origin. That is how the light is made up of. So that made the famous theory called electromagnetic wave theory. Okay, so new theory was arise, and Maxwell gave a satisfactory explanation for how does light travel in vacuum. Okay, so according to Maxwell, light is an electromagnetic wave. Suppose there is a light traveling in Z direction, and if its magnetic field, electric field is varying along x-axis, and the magnetic field is varying along y-axis, then electric field varies sinusoidally, and it is like this. At this point, the electric field is a little bit stronger. Here it is zero, here it is very strong, here it's maximum, and electric field here is weak, and here it is zero, negative electric field here. And so this is how we show it diagrammatically. Electric field is shown diagrammatically like this. Now, with the arrow marks, showing that this is the peak value of electric field, E naught, say. And this is the picture at a moment, it is not a permanent picture. Very next moment, it may change. That means electric field may become zero here, it may become strong here. And you know that whenever there is a change in electric field, that induces a current, or so that produces a current. We call that current as displacement current. And that displacement current can produce magnetic field. So there should be a magnetic field. So light is a combination of electric and magnetic fields. I don't have colored chalk, very sorry. No chalk here. Okay, let it be. So there should be a magnetic field in this direction. So a magnetic field will also exist like this, and it is also timely varying. Now this is the picture at a particular moment only. Very next moment, here magnetic field will collapse, and here also it will collapse, and here it will become maximum. Now if you want to write, so this is B naught. If you want to write the equations for electric and magnetic fields, it will be like this. E is equal to electric field at any moment at a particular point is E naught sine kz, this is E along x-axis, Ex equal to E naught sine kz minus omega t, right? Kz minus omega t. Because it travels in z-axis. Okay, what is the magnetic field along y-axis? Its variation can be represented as B naught sine kz minus omega t, where omega is angular frequency. What is angular frequency? It is 2 pi by t or 2 pi nu. And what is k? K is called wave number. Its value is 2 pi by lambda. So this is how he explained it. It is simply like a sinusoidal wave, transverse wave. Light is a transverse wave. The electric and magnetic fields are perpendicular to each other, and they are mutually perpendicular to the direction of propagation of wave. If the direction of propagation of wave is in Z direction, then electric field will be varying along Y direction, and magnetic field will be varying along Y direction. Yeah, electric field will be varying along X direction, and magnetic field will be varying along Z direction. Electric field will be varying along X direction, and magnetic field will be varying along Y direction, and all the three are mutually perpendicular to each other. All the three are mutually perpendicular. Now, using this, Maxwell was able to give a set of equations using his theory, and he was able to prove that light is a combination of electric and magnetic fields. And one equation is velocity of light is nothing but 1 by root of mu naught epsilon naught. This is one equation he gave, where mu naught is the permeability of the medium and epsilon naught is the permittivity of the medium. You know, you are aware of all these terms. So C is equal to 1 by root of mu naught epsilon naught, right? This is one formula, and also C is equal to, you know, the velocity selector formula is the same type of formula, E naught by B naught, where E naught is the strength of the magnetic field, electric field, and B naught is the strength of the magnetic field, the peak values. And also you can write one more thing here. You see, C is equal to omega by K. How come? Very simple. Omega is 2 pi nu. What is K? 2 pi by lambda. 2 pi gets cancelled. C is equal to nu lambda. You know this formula very well. V is equal to F lambda we write, right? Velocity of any wave is frequency into wavelength. But here it is light, so velocity of light is frequency into wavelength. Okay, that is another formula, right? C is equal to omega by K, C is equal to nu lambda, right? And another thing here important you have to observe. Electric and magnetic fields, these two, they are in phase. What do you mean by in phase? Now you can understand what is in phase, right? Electric and magnetic fields in electromagnetic wave are in phase. Meaning, wherever you have the highest electric field, at the same point you have the highest magnetic field. Wherever the electric field is zero, at the same point magnetic field is also zero. So when the magnetic field grows negative maximum, electric field grows negative maximum. So wherever magnetic field is negative maximum, electric field is also negative maximum. So whenever electric field is highest, magnetic field is also highest. Whenever electric field is zero, magnetic field is also zero. So both are in phase. So light is a combination of timely varying electric and magnetic fields, and all are mutually timely varying electric and magnetic fields perpendicular to the direction of propagation of wave, perpendicular to each other also, and all the three are mutually perpendicular to each other. Velocity of light, or the direction of propagation of light, the direction of electric field, and the direction of magnetic field. All the three are mutually perpendicular to each other. So all the formulas, very important here. Okay, so that's how he explained. He gave a set of formulas. We are referring only a few formulas here. For the propagation of wave. And so now Huygen, in what area Huygen went wrong? That is he failed to explain how does the light travel in vacuum. If light is a combination of electric and magnetic field, there is no question of thinking about how does light travel in vacuum, because electric field, magnetic field, they can just simply fluctuate anywhere, right? They need not have a medium. So if light is a combination of electric and magnetic field, what is the need of medium? So it can travel in even vacuum, because electric and magnetic fields can exist even in vacuum. So because you have a formula here, right? Mu naught epsilon naught. Velocity of light is mu naught epsilon naught, where mu naught is the permittivity of free space. Epsilon naught is the mu naught is the permeability of free space. Epsilon naught is the permittivity of free space. So and if light is traveling in some other medium, so light is a non-mechanical wave. It can travel in vacuum as well as in media also. If it is traveling in any medium, then you have to write the formula like this, mu epsilon, right? Where mu is the permeability of that medium, which is not permeability of free space, and epsilon is the permeability of that medium. So this is the velocity of light in any medium. So how does electromagnetic wave, light, travels in vacuum? Is self-explained, because it is a combination of electric and magnetic fields perpendicular to each other, and both perpendicular to the direction of propagation of the wave. And it is timely varying electric and magnetic field. It is not a constant electric and magnetic field, because if you want to produce magnetic field, you have to have a timely varying electric field. So this idea of light, that is the electromagnetic wave, made a tremendous change. Remember, nowadays, if you have mobile communication and all the TV communication, sending the signals through the antennas, receiving it through another antennas, and sending the electromagnetic wave, everything, mobile communication, everything is possible, because we were able to, and Maxwell was able to say that light is an electromagnetic wave. And later on, the same electromagnetic wave was practically proved by Henry Charles in his laboratory. And he was able to produce some electromagnetic waves and receive it at a certain distance. That was the first transmission and reception. First transmission of electromagnetic wave through a distance in the laboratory itself, and reception in another ring, antenna was done by Hertz, Henry Charles. And later on it was developed by Marconi and so many scientists, of course. And Bose, Indian Bose, right, radio communication. So all these things. Went on, and nowadays we have all the communication using electromagnetic waves. Okay, so this is about that explanation of light as an electromagnetic wave. Now, if you move on, sir, then for the production of electromagnetic wave, we have a set of electromagnetic waves, right? Starting from gamma rays, the lowest wavelength, till radio waves, the highest wavelength and the lowest frequency. And sir, how are they produced? There are different ways of producing these electromagnetic waves, because we have a timely varying electric field, right? So as soon as the timely varying electric field exists, there should be a current and there should be a magnetic field. Okay. One, the source for or the way in which electromagnetic wave is produced is one, accelerated charge. Any accelerated charge is a source of electromagnetic wave. Right? Second, oscillating charge is also a source for electromagnetic wave. Oscillating charge is also a source for electromagnetic wave because it is also accelerated. You know that any oscillation in that velocity changes with time and it is an acceleration. Oscillating charge is also a source for electromagnetic wave. And the third one, transition of electrons from higher energy level to the lower energy level. Transition of electrons from higher energy to lower energy level. So that may also lead to the emission of electromagnetic wave. Third, fourth one, when a fast moving electron is stopped suddenly by a metal target. You see the production of X-rays, how it was done. A fast moving electron is suddenly stopped by a metal target. That leads to X-rays. So that is also possible. So you may be asked here in the examination, you may be asked to mention this. Mention the sources of production of electromagnetic waves. One, accelerated charge, oscillating charge, and fast moving electrons suddenly stopped by a metal target. And another one is transition of electrons from higher level energy level to the lower energy level. This is a chapter which is famous for 1 or 2 marks questions. Usually you will get 1 or 2 mark question. Sometimes they will ask you, of course this is not over and you will have to study all the properties of electromagnetic radiations. You may be asked, let us see what type of questions you may be asked in the exam. One is, who identified inconsistency in Ampere's circuital law? One, Maxwell. And what is the inconsistency? That it cannot be applied to find out the magnetic field between the plates of a charging capacitor. Not possible. Okay. What is Ampere's circuital law? Closed integral of B dot dl is equal to mu naught times the net current enclosed in the area bounded by the loop. It is the total current enclosed in the area bounded by the loop. Okay, what is Maxwell-Ampere rule or law? Maxwell-Ampere law is closed integral of B dot dl is equal to mu naught times two currents. One is conduction current and another is displacement current. What do you mean by displacement current? Current due to timely varying electric field is called displacement current. What do you mean by conduction current? Current due to the flow of charges or drift of charges, electrons in a conductor is that is the conduction current. Okay, do you have any formula for displacement current? Yes, displacement current ID is equal to epsilon naught d phi electric field, electric flux, rate of change of electric flux. So that is the formula. So if you use that formula, then you will get B dot dl is equal to mu naught times IC plus mu naught times ID. ID is epsilon naught d phi by dt. This is actually the Ampere-Maxwell law or formula. Okay. And further, what is the electromagnetic wave? Light is an electromagnetic wave. It is a combination of electric and magnetic fields, timely varying electric and magnetic fields aligned perpendicular to each other, and they are mutually perpendicular to the direction of propagation of the wave. So how do you write the equation for the variation of electric field? If the electric field varies along x direction, then E naught sine kz minus omega t, because it travels in the z direction, and x is perpendicular to z, and magnetic field, if it varies along y direction, B naught sine kz minus omega t. Of course, you can interchange this, no problem. It need not be only along that direction. So it will be like this, okay, and magnetic field will be like this, okay, here, this is, so like this here, E, and here, B, and this is Z. And what formulas Maxwell gave? One is velocity of light. This is very important. Velocity of light, according to Maxwell, is 1 by root of mu naught epsilon naught. Very important formula. Write the formula for the velocity of light given by Maxwell. So, like this. In terms of permittivity and permeability. Permeability mu naught and permittivity epsilon naught. It is like this. Sometimes they may ask this for one more question like this. Very simple. What is the dimension of 1 by root of mu naught epsilon naught? Sir, how to find out the dimension of 1 by root of mu naught epsilon naught? You need not worry because you know what is this on the right hand side. It is just velocity of light. So if it is velocity of light, then it should be Lt to the power minus 1 because this is velocity. But you must know that it is velocity. Now what is the dimension of mu naught epsilon naught if it is asked? Then it is the reverse, right? Because it is 1 by velocity, of course, root of mu naught epsilon naught. It is 1 by velocity, L minus 1 t. That's all. Dimension. Very simple. Okay. What else we have? Right. Other formulas given by Maxwell. C is equal to E naught by B naught. And C is equal to omega by K. And then, yeah, you have still few more formulas. That is omega is equal to 2 pi nu. And K is equal to 2 pi wave number. K is called wave number, omega is angular frequency. One more, we have forgotten two formulas. One, energy density. You know that light is a form of energy. So if it travels in the form of electric and magnetic field, what is the energy included in the space wherever you get light? Energy density per unit volume, right? That means energy density means energy per unit volume. Energy per unit volume is given by, we will write it as U. It is B squared by, B means the highest, maximum magnetic field, peak value of magnetic field divided by 2 mu naught. And in terms of electric field, energy density is given by half epsilon naught E square, right? So these two formulas. Energy density is the energy per unit volume. So energy per unit volume due to an electromagnetic radiation is given by B square by 2 mu naught, that is due to magnetic field, where B is the peak value of magnetic field, and energy density at a point is half epsilon naught E square, where E is the peak value of electric field. And there is one more thing called radiation pressure. What do you mean by radiation pressure? Whenever electromagnetic radiations fall on any surface, they exert a pressure. And that amount of pressure is very less. For example, when light falls on your head or surface, body surface, it exerts pressure as if some objects are falling on any surface and putting pressure on the surface. So, radiation will also exert pressure on the surface on which it falls. That is called radiation pressure. And suppose you want to find out the momentum applied or momentum created. Suppose you want to write the momentum. Momentum exerted or transferred. Momentum transferred by electromagnetic radiations whenever they fall on any surface is given by P is equal to, you can write it as U by C. Energy density or energy per velocity of light. Because you know that if you use Einstein's mass energy relation, then it comes here. U is mc square by C. What is this? Momentum, isn't it? Mass into velocity. Very simple. So, momentum transfer, you know, if you take light as an object, if it falls on a surface, it transfers momentum as if you throw a ball and it falls on a stone and stone moves, right? So, the same way, but light transfers some momentum to any object it falls. If a light of energy U falls on any surface, the momentum transferred is U by C, okay? Momentum is U by C, and so this definition may be asked, what is radiation pressure? Radiation pressure is the pressure exerted by the electromagnetic radiation when it falls on any surface. Suppose you are asked to find out how to calculate the radiation pressure. Say, light falls on any surface, and if it is completely absorbed, let us say, how to calculate the radiation pressure? You know that pressure is force by area. But what is force according to the Newton's second law? rate of change of momentum is the force, right? So how do you calculate this? Radiation pressure is equal to force. So force is calculated as dp by dt into 1 by a. Rate of change of momentum is the applied force. How to calculate dp? dp is calculated only by using this formula. How? If the light of momentum p is equal to u by c falls on the surface, and if it gets absorbed by the surface, change in momentum is, so you can write it as dt here, a here, change in momentum is p minus 0, finished. P minus 0, because once the light electromagnetic radiation falls on the surface, momentum is p, and if it is absorbed, momentum is 0. P minus 0 by dt by a, that's all. And if we want to find out the radiation pressure, if the light gets reflected, if the electromagnetic radiation falling on a surface gets reflected, then what is the radiation pressure? Of course, this is pressure. Then force by area. Force is rate of change of momentum. In this case, if it gets reflected, formula goes like this. It will be, so radiation pressure is equal to force by area. Force is rate of change of momentum. Okay, I have to write equal to rate of change of momentum by area. That is equal. What is rate of change of momentum? Now it is P minus of minus P divided by dt. Yeah. Now radiation pressure is 2p by dt a. Why? Because light of momentum goes to the surface, hits the surface and returns back. If p is the momentum while going to the surface and p is the momentum while it is coming back, if it is completely reflected, then 2p, you will have change in momentum, p minus of minus p, per second and divided by time into area. Or divided by area. So that gives the radiation pressure. So you can find it out like that. This is the method of finding, right? So all the formulas and energy density due to magnetic field, energy density due to electric field, and momentum transferred by the light to any object on it falls, and radiation pressure on the object on which it falls, and all these formulas are one more questions. So we will have the properties of electromagnetic radiations in the next class. Thanks for watching the class. We will meet in the next class with the remaining theory. Thank you.